Faith Matters. An interactive program brought to you by MTA International.
Assalamu alaikum and welcome to another edition of Faith Matters, where you, our viewers, set the agenda by the questions you ask. Jazakum Allah and thank you for the questions you have sent in. But for those viewers not yet familiar with our email address, well, I'll give you it right here at the head of the program. It's faithmatters@mta.tv. That's faithmatters, one word, at mta.tv. As our regular viewers will know, you can actually find previous Faith Matters programs on YouTube. You go to YouTube, put in the words MTA Online 1, Faith Matters, the name of the program, and the subject you're after, and hopefully away you'll go there. And if not, you know what to do. Write to us here on faithmatters@mta.tv. With that, it's my pleasure to introduce to our viewers, to regular panelists and scholars of the Ahmadiyya Muslim community. Assalamu alaikum, gentlemen. Welcome to Faith Matters. To my immediate right, of course, is Dr. Zaid Ahmed Khan Sahib, who is the president of the Qaza Board here in the United Kingdom. Assalamu alaikum, Dr. Sahib. And to his right is, of course, Maulana Abdul Ghani Jahangir Khan Sahib, who is a senior missionary and head of the French desk here in the United Kingdom. Welcome, Jahangir Sahib, to Faith Matters. Gentlemen, we'll start with our first question, which comes from Germany, from Hola Maham Mahmoud. Assalamu alaikum, and thank you for your question. Jahangir Sahib, she's asking that, are all sins of Muslims forgiven? And if so, are they only forgiven by the performance of Hajj or Umrah, which are, of course, the pilgrimage to Mecca?
The greater pilgrimage and the lesser pilgrimage in Islam. Not at all. There's no hard and fast rule about if you've gone for Hajj, then all your sins have been forgiven, or for Umrah or anything else for that matter. And we have the illustration of this story from the history of Islam, where there was a saintly person in Iraq who had saved up money to go to the Hajj, but then something happened. Now, there was a person who had been to the Hajj and who had received a revelation from Allah after the Hajj had been completed, where he heard that Allah was saying that not a single Hajj of any person who took part in it this year has been accepted, except for one person, and he wasn't even there. He didn't even go for the Hajj, but his Hajj was accepted. So he wanted to know who that person was, and the name was told to him, that it's a certain person who lives on this certain street of Baghdad. Mm-hmm. So he went there. He wanted to find this amazing person who didn't even go for Hajj, but who had their Hajj accepted. And therefore, if the Hajj has been accepted, then we can say that Allah has given, favors, bounties, and also forgiven their sins if it's been accepted. Then he found out from the person, when he told the person, that, are you this person that that I'm looking for? And he said, yes. And he said, well, this is why I've come to see you, because I was told this in a revelation. So what did you do to get a Hajj without even going there? And he said, well, the only thing I can think of is that I had saved to go to Hajj, no doubt, but I didn't go because just before I set off on the journey, I one day smelled some very nice meat cooking at my neighbor's. Very delicious smell. So I went there, knocked on his door and said that I want to claim my right as a neighbor to get a small portion of whatever you're cooking because it smells so nice. And the neighbor said, well, I'm very sad to inform you that you will not be able to get that. He said, why? I'm your neighbor. I have a right to it, according to Islam. Mm-hmm. So he said, it's halal for us, but it's haram for you. He said, how could it be halal for one and not for the other? We're both Muslims, are we not? He said, I still maintain that it's halal for us, but haram for you. So when he pressed him further to say what he meant by that, he said that my children have been starving for so many days, and I came across the carcass of a dead donkey in the streets. I cut off a portion of that, and that's what we're cooking. So it's halal for us, because we're starving, but it's haram for you. Mm-hmm. He said that when he heard that, he said, how could I even think of going to Hajj when my neighbor is dying of starvation? So he went home, got the amount of money that he'd saved for the Hajj, and gave it to the neighbor, the whole of it. And Allah said only his Hajj was accepted that year. Mm-hmm. So as we see, the acceptance of Hajj is not even contingent upon going to Hajj itself, as has been illustrated here. It all depends on the sincerity of the person, the devotion of the person, and their intention, of course. And so we can't say with certainty that the Hajj or Umrah is going to get anyone's sins forgiven. It may well be that certain years everybody goes there in their millions and nobody has anything forgiven at all, because Allah knows what's in the hearts of the people. Maybe there are thousands who are getting their sins forgiven. It belongs to Allah to decide. We really can't judge that. So we hope that inshallah, if anyone goes for Hajj with that pure intention of having their sins forgiven, then Allah maybe might accept that. Mm-hmm. We can only hope and pray.
Jazakum Allah, Jahangir Sahib, for that very comprehensive answer. And as you've said, you know, it's really ultimately it's up to God to forgive sins in whatever shape or form. We'll move on to our next question, which comes from Saad Ahmed from Toronto in Canada. Dr. Sahib, his question's ranging or is based around the prophecies of the founder of the Ahmadiyya Muslim community, Hazrat Mirza Ghulam Ahmed, and his prophecies. And he, in his question, puts down the fact that there were various prophecies relating to plagues, deaths of certain people, predictions of the future, so on and so forth. His question is, how can one be sure that these prophecies were prophesied before the events occurred? And he points to the plague prophecy in particular, and were in fact authentic predictions of the future. That said, he's also quoted something about the Shah of Iran, and there are prophecies which are perhaps, again, more relevant and coming true today. So again, that in itself is an answer. Mark, over to you.
Well, all prophets of Allah have this given to them, that they are given signs and prophecies of things that will happen in the future. And this is one way of showing their truth and for people to recognize the truth of prophets. And it has happened with all the previous prophets. And certainly the same thing happened with the promised Messiah, alayhi salam. In fact, his own coming was in fulfillment of a prophecy of the Holy Prophet of Islam, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So that also was proof of the truth of the promised Messiah, alayhi salam. Hazrat Masih Maud, alayhi salam, the promised Messiah, the founder of the Ahmadiyya Muslim community, received many prophecies from the Allah the Almighty. Mm-hmm. And on many occasions, he would actually tell the people around him that he had received this prophecy, and people actually saw the fulfillment of those prophecies. Other times he would actually publish leaflets, which would then be put out into newspapers, would be displayed, would be distributed mm-hmm. amongst people in India at that time, and then people would actually witness that the fulfillment of these prophecies that had come true. So this is something that every person can look into the literature of the Ahmadi Muslim community, that Hazrat Masih Maud has included many of these prophecies mm-hmm. in the books that he wrote, in the Ruhani Khazain that he has left, the treasures that he has left, with spiritual treasures that he has left. The prophecies of this nature are mentioned by the promised Messiah, alayhi salam, and then the fulfillment of those prophecies also have something that history has shown as to have come true. Many of the original texts of the books, some people may say that the books have been changed by the community to include these prophecies afterwards, but many of the original texts of those books dating back from the time of the promised Messiah are present in the community, can be cross-checked and see that these prophecies were certainly made before the events actually took place. This is important to realize that. But the promised Messiah emphasized to people around him and widely around him that if you want to see signs that are given to me, come and spend some time with me in Qadian. And daily Allah is showing me these prophecies and these signs. And you and I will show you that Allah speaks with me and gives me signs of the future. So this was something that many, many people did do and went to stay with him and were actually witness to these things, that Allah was speaking and showing promised Messiah, alayhi salam, signs. The plague was a very great sign. In fact, the plague during the time of the Masih and Mahdi were predictions of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as well. So those are prophecies that relate back to the Holy Prophet of Islam sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And therefore, their fulfillment during the time of the promised Messiah alayhi salam mm-hmm. was certainly fulfillment, that these prophecies had been made before the events actually took place. And this was clear recognition of the truth of Hazrat Masih Maud alayhi salam to that degree.
Jazakumullah. And of course, there's many prophecies one can, well, I mean, one of the ones we witness ourselves through the wonders of MTA, of course, is that when God promised that I shall cause thy message to reach the four corners of the earth, here was a man who started through divine revelation a community in Qadian. It's a very remote village in India, and today we see the Islam that is followed by millions within the Ahmadiyya Muslim community prospering across the world.
Another simple one is, God is so pleased with thee that kings will seek blessings from thy garments. Now imagine Qadiana, a remote village in India, had no sort of contact with the outside world. There was no telephone, there was no rail at that time before the Prophet Muhammad, and he is saying that kings will seek blessings from his garments, and the one that you mentioned of I will spread thy message to the corners of the earth.
Very tall claims.
Very tall claims at that time, you know, this single man, very simple man who is not supported by anyone, who is on his own, and he makes these claims. Wild claims that some people may say, but today when you look at the message of Ahmadiyyat Islam, true Islam, it has spread to the corners of the earth. The Jamaat has centers around the world, the mosques are around the world, and the Khalifatul Masih, when he addresses every Friday, I mean, that message is taken around the whole world, and that is the message of the promised Messiah alayhi salam. And also kings, there were kings who have obviously been took garments of the promised Messiah alayhi salam for the blessings that were contained in them, and that was fulfillment of those prophecies as well that were given to the Prophet.
JazakumAllah, Dr. Sahib, and my thanks also to Saad Ahmed Sahib of Toronto for your question. Our next one comes from Mashoud Jalo from Guinea-Bissau in West Africa. Jahangir Sahib, he's asking that, and he's talking about the context of many countries across the world, I guess, but his question is, how can an individual citizen stop his own countrymen from cruelty and injustice?
Yes, this is actually an injunction of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He said, you must help the oppressor and the oppressed. Whereupon his companions, of course, asked the question, which is the obvious one, that we do understand how to help the oppressed, but how does one go about helping the oppressor? And he said, you should try to stay his hand from cruelty and tyranny. Now, the whole thing boils down to how do we go about doing that? And we've seen that since the beginning, Muslims have, following the practice of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, very humbly and respectfully stood bravely in front of their leaders and told them that they do not think that the policies that they are pursuing in whatever regard, in whatever field, are conducive to peace. And that if they do it this way, then maybe it might be better. So a Muslim is duty-bound to do that. And usually, if the people aren't absolute, you know, tyrants and full of themselves, so to speak, they do listen. You know, it all depends on how the person puts it forward. It mustn't be in an arrogant fashion. It must be in a very heartfelt, sincere fashion, and then people do tend to listen. But beyond that, an individual in society, of course, there are many things that they could have recourse to. One is to take part in the electoral system and actually go and vote, cast their vote when it's time to do so. Because change can be brought about by bringing in a different party, for example. So they should make full use of that opportunity which is made available to them. But also, on an individual level, people can join politics to try and change politics from within. And of course, Lord Ahmadiyya would be better placed to talk about that here. But as we know in the Jamaat, the Ahmadiyya Jamaat, our policy is that we don't, as a Jamaat, take part in politics, but our individuals within the Jamaat are absolutely free to do so, and they do so, in all the different parties, may I add, in whichever country. So there are many ways where the individual can bring a change about. But having said that, there are certain things which are also frowned upon in Islam, and one of them is to have demonstrations out in the streets. Because however peaceful they may start off as, they always end up in some kind of disorder, some kind of trouble. They are sometimes joined by troublemakers. So people can go with the best intentions of the world, but then they could see that their ranks are swelling because of other people joining them who don't have those intentions. And so it's always best to steer clear from such manifestations and protests in the streets. The best way to do it is to have a dialogue. And so to try and talk to people in power, the powers that be, and try to change things in that way. But also people have to pray for their nation. Because as we know, the love of one's nation, how many times have we said it? The Prophet ﷺ gave us this beautiful motto to live by, that love of one's nation is part and parcel of your faith. And so we must therefore pray for our nation, that our nation does not fall into these problems. And when it does, we should pray that Allah removes the nation from these problems. And this also brings great blessings, draws blessings to the nation. Indeed, we see many countries where the leaders really take this to heart, and they do call the religious leaders of different groups together to pray for the nation on specific days, for example. I know that's true, for example, of Ghana, of Mauritius. There are different countries that do that, and this is very conducive to societal peace. So there is quite a lot that individuals can do, whether by prayers, by advice, or by joining, politics as such, but by steering clear of adding fuel to the fire by demonstrations or things which can get even worse than that. So that has to be avoided at all costs by Muslims.
Just as a final point on this, Dr. Saab, as well, there's quite sort of specific instruction also about respect for not just law and order, but for good governance as well. Indeed, the example of the Promised Messiah, the founder of the Ambia Muslim community, the time of British rule in India, was one of respecting the fact that religious freedoms weren't just guarded and protected, people were allowed to practice and profess as well.
Yes, we see the situation in India, British India at that time, that they gave complete freedom, religious freedom to all these society and all the religions. And taking that into account, the Promised Messiah made it absolutely clear that we are faithful to this government and we are respectful of it and we support it for these reasons that they support us in our freedom, religious freedoms. Whereas prior to that, Muslims were not given religious freedom and they were not allowed to give the azan and so on. Their mosques were looted. But when the British gave them religious freedom to that degree, then we are faithful and we support the government, whoever that is. You see, the Prophet of Islam sallallahu alaihi wasallam also said that whoever is appointed above you, on top of you, then you have to abide by that. And you have to pray for that. So if they are being the oppressor, then you have to, as Jahangir Saab says, that you have to carry on your peaceful protest in that respect and peaceful protest to Allah, in fact, that Allah should remove any sort of government that is placed upon you who do not show you mercy. And mercy in religious fields is the most important. And that is why we have found that Muslims, Ahmadi Muslims, wherever they are, who enjoy the freedoms of religion, will always abide and are loyal to the governments that they exist in.
There was one point which I wanted to make, because you see, today we see that the Muslim lands are in turmoil. Mm-hmm. Everywhere you see, these protests and people getting shot and killed and etc. It's a terrible set of circumstances which we're seeing unfolding before our eyes. But how do we deal with people who are not giving the rights to the people? We see that there is a set of injunctions in the Quran about that. Mm-hmm. When the story of Moses was given forward, it wasn't just to tell us a nice story. It was so that we could draw some lessons from it. He was sent to the greatest tyrant of the age, the Pharaoh. And what did Allah say for him? He didn't say go and overturn his government. He didn't say go and protest out in the streets. He didn't assassinate him. He said go and tell him a qawlan layyina, which means go and tell him a soft word, something which would be easily digestible to him. Speak to him in a serene fashion, so that he doesn't take offense, because he's an arrogant person. So you have to speak to him like that. And this is what Moses did. Now, whether it worked or not is another issue, but that's the way that that prophet of God dealt with the situation. So we should follow in the footsteps of these prophets. And we shouldn't take the law into our own hands. It always bodes ill when people try to do that. This is why in the Ahmadiyya Muslim community, we are always away from all those things. And we advise other Muslims also to steer clear of these things.
Jazakumullah, gentlemen. And just as a final word on that, Dr. Saab, in no way does it sort of negate that one's right to, we talked about protest, but protest within the context of the law. So whether it's, lobbying your member of parliament, whether it's raising issues of concerns over existing laws, which may, in your mind, be in need for reform in a positive way, that also is a proactive contribution to the welfare of society, community and country.
Many ways to protest, as you rightly say, and those are something that are recommended for Muslims to carry out. that we have to look out for the interest of the society at large, not for our own interest actually, but for society at large. If there are other factions of society, then we have to obviously fight their battle as such as well. If there are people who are oppressed, and we have to fight their cause. And this is what the Jamaat has actually done in other parts of the world and continues to do to this day through the democratic factions that there are, that we will continue to fight those cause and bring this to the forefront of the public so that people are aware of that, and then try to do something to change that situation and try to bring about a betterment for those people who are oppressed.
And I suppose as a very good example of that, the current sort of laws which were passed in Pakistan, for example, which were specifically targeting the Ahmadiyya Muslim community, the community's conduct thereafter is an example of that living example today.
We see that throughout the history, since these laws were promulgated in Pakistan about discrimination against Ahmadis, we have continued this effort throughout to try to ease that situation, but also with regard to the other minorities in Pakistan, with regard to Christians and so on. The Jamaat has always been is supportive of the measures that can be brought in to improve the situation as well as far as these other religious minorities are concerned. That is true Islam, you see. That is the Islam of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that all religions are free to live and practice their religions, and therefore we Ahmadis as Muslims, we do fight their cause and make sure that Hindus, Muslims and Sikhs and all other factions live peacefully amongst each other. The Promised Messiah alayhi salam said, you cannot be a Muslim if your neighbor's house, a Hindu house or a Sikh house is on fire and that you have not done anything about it. So this is the duty that has been laid down upon us by the Promised Messiah alayhi salam in this respect as well.
Jazakumullah, gentlemen, for your answers there, and my thanks also to Mashud Saab for your question as well. Our next question comes from Agha Rizwan. Thank you for your kind comments about faith matters. Jangir Saab, this particular question relates to a Friday sermon of the current Caliph of the Ahmadiyya Muslim community delivered on the 5th of July. And during that sermon, Hazur made a statement about referring to who is Dajjal, and the context of that was, you know, is Dajjal is not an individual, but maybe a collection of people, a group of people. And our question is asking, really, can you enlighten me upon or expand upon what was actually constitutes this group of people?
Well, we have spoken about this on a few occasions during these Faith Matters recordings. But just very briefly, the Dajjal is taken these days by many Muslims, even now, to represent a, you know, scary creature, some kind of a monstrous figure, a one-eyed monster who will come and, you know, cause rampage on earth, etc. And after wreaking all this havoc, then Jesus will descend from the heavens and will fight him and kill him at the gate of Lud, etc. So there are many things like this which are taken very, very literally by you know, certain Muslims, which is a shame because it belittles the message of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to the same degree. But what we do know is that if you study the root meanings of the words used by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam or the Quran, then you will find many answers within those meanings themselves. And we know that the word Dajjal means the arch deceiver as first meaning, but that in the root word of Dajjala there are many meanings. One is to be a people so numerous that they cover the surface of the earth, or to be a people who are so you know, into traveling for commercial purposes that their travelings cover the whole surface of the earth. So there are certain meanings which are linked to that as well, and therefore we see that even in the root meaning there is this idea of it being a people and not just, you know, an individual. Mm-hmm. But then when you read what the Dajjal does, I mean, we don't have time to go into all that today, but when we read what he does in the world, then we do come to understand that actually the Dajjal is a people, because it's something which people are doing in the world, it's not just one individual. So as the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, that any people who would accept their hegemony would be, you know, benefiting. They would cause the rain to fall on their crops for them, their cows would leave, you know, thin in the mornings and come back with full rumps in the afternoons, etc. Whereas those who would oppose the system of those people, which is called the arch-deceiving system, mm-hmm. which we should maybe say a word about why it's called that, they would suffer all kinds of torments, war, famines, etc. So why is it a deception? It's because people are being told to let go of real divinity, the real divinity of God, and to go after something which is bringing them onto materialism, in fact. And this is why the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam warned the Muslims. Mm-hmm. He said, there is not a prophet on whoever appeared on earth but warned his people against the coming of the Antichrist. Mm-hmm. It will be the biggest evil since the creation of the heavens and the earth to afflict mankind. Because due to this system whereby people are told that this is the be-all and end-all of it all, mm-hmm. so make the best of your life, go for materialism, consumerism. That's what you have to go for. Look where it's landed us now. Look at our planet. Our planet is suffering because of this system. Never before has a system so, you know, blighted the world as this. And now the people themselves in the West are realizing it. There are many who are raising their voices against this exploitation which is going on in the world and are trying to find measures to stop the destruction of the planet and to give their rights back to those people who lost, those nations who lost their wealth to the system. You know, because now there's a backlash as well. Those nations are now rising up, and now we see terrorism, and now we see all these things. So all this evil was predicted by the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and it also meant, of course, that the Muslims would be severely affected by all this. So those Muslims who do not recognize what this materialistic system is, which takes them away from God, then they also are running after that third and fourth car, and you know, all this, the things, you know, keeping up with the Joneses thing, you know, and going out exploiting, you know, others instead of giving them their rights. So they are also taking part in the system of the Antichrist, you see.
So you have this system, Zakumullah, of consumerism against, if you like, the purity of faith. But looking at it in the global context, and Dr. Zaid, perhaps I come to you on this as well, that some who argue, let's take some of these extremist institutions which are set up in the name of Islam, who exploit the poor by providing an education, in some cases providing food and water, basic necessities, but taking young, minds that are like sponges, taking them out, putting them into institutions and perhaps instilling in them such a perverse interpretation of Islam, that in itself is an exploitation of the worst kind, and it's a demonizing of faith, which in itself means purity and peace, yet is being presented, as we all know in the world today, as this kind of terrorist concept, which is so removed from the origins and the true principles of the faith, but nevertheless is a perception that this is what the faith represents.
Absolutely. I mean, it's a brainwashing of impressionable minds that continues, and it is the promise and the promise of paradise that if you carry out these acts, then this is what will take you to paradise. And it is that erroneous picture of Islam that has been presented to these people, and that is why these acts are being undertaken. But even from that, the aspect of Dajjal comes out very clearly, in that the Dajjal was going to be a one-eyed monster, in that he would be blind in his right eye. And this is exactly what we see, is that the right eye is something that is pointing towards spiritualism, something that is towards godly, and there is no sight in that. So these people are completely unaware of religion as such. And they're completely, totally blind as far as religion is concerned, whereas that left eye is so powerful, and the left is something that depicts materialism or advancement or progression of this world, nothing to do with spirituality to that extent. So this is the imbalance that one sees, that left eye is so powerful that it penetrates into the depths of the earth, you know. So they're able to, all the advancements that we see scientific of how they have been looting the earth from its treasures is what is really meant in that. And the left eye is towards materialism, and as Jahangir Sahib has said, this is what we see, that the nations who are only got one-sighted vision, that this is their only goal, and they have no interest in spiritualism, and it is this imbalance that has created the problem that was predicted by the Holy Prophet of Islam sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and it also pointed to the timing of when the promised Messiah and Mahdi would come, as to when the battle with that would be, and true Islam will then conquer this Dajjal, and that is how Islam would conquer the world.
Gentlemen, Jazakumullah, again, a vast subject, and I'm sure we can devote the whole program to it, but thank you very much for your very detailed answers, and my thanks also to Ahmad Rizwan for the question. Our next one is from Annie Zahid. It's a question about food and seafood in particular, Dr. Sahib. And conflicting views have been heard by our questioner about what is halal, i.e. that which comes from the ocean or the sea. On one hand, our questioner writes that some people say everything in the ocean is halal, while on the other hand, other suggestions have been made that things such as lobsters, sharks and shrimp are not allowed. Would you be able to provide some clarifications? I'm sure our viewers are now watching with great trepidation, particularly those who are lovers of seafood, perhaps, to see what you say, but over to you.
Well, let's see what Islam says. I mean, the dietary laws in Islam are very simple, as compared with, say, for instance, Judaism, where they're very complicated and very difficult for us to always understand and follow. But as far as Islam is concerned, and looking at the question, regarding what is in the ocean and what is in the sea, I mean, the Quran is very explicit and clear about that, that anything and everything that is in the sea is halal, is permitted to you, is not haram. So from that angle, we have to understand that Allah the Almighty has clearly made this definition that those creatures that live in the sea are permitted for us, and that does include lobsters, sharks and shrimps and so on. Where some Muslims actually have this idea that these are perhaps not permitted by Islam is that when they look at Judaic laws of dietary laws, where crustaceans, those with a shell, they are not permitted to consume those. So that is where perhaps this comes from. But the other thing with Islamic dietary laws, and it is only with regard to Islam that this is, it is not mentioned that this is halal, but also another aspect, another condition is also attached to dietary laws, that it is tayyib. Mm-hmm. Now tayyib is something that is very beautiful to understand as far as dietary of the whole universe is, or the world is concerned, because that is wholesome. So what some people or some groups may find wholesome in some parts of the world, in other parts of the world they may not find it at all wholesome, and they stay quite clear away from that. So these two things have to be taken together to understand the dietary laws of Islam, and they can be very much personal as well. Mm-hmm. That maybe something that is wholesome for me, you may not find wholesome for you, and therefore you will not partake of it. And that again is something that Islam lays down, that you have these options, and within that framework some things are permissible, some things are totally not permissible, and of those, then the permissible things, they have to be wholesome as well, and that can, as I say, either be individual or as a collective nation, that we find some foods are wholesome to some people. But the Holy Quran is very clear on creatures of the sea, that they are permissible and permitted to Muslims, and this is what we find in tradition, that the Muslims on an expedition, they came across a very big sea animal which had landed, and the Muslims army at that time were very hungry, and they had been on this expedition, but they were not sure whether this was permitted or not. But the Muslims were told that this certainly was permitted, and this animal, this shark or whatever it was such a big creature that a man could stand in the eyeball socket of this creature. So this shows us that even something that is such huge and gigantic off the sea, perhaps even bigger than a whale and bigger than a shark, was permitted to the Muslims at the time of the Holy Prophet of Islam, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and that comes from the holy teachings of the Holy Quran as far as dietary laws are concerned.
Gentlemen, Jazakumullah, thank you for your answers, and my thanks also to Anis Zahid for the question. Our next questioner is based in India, Vajahat Ahmed, writes from Kerala in India. Describes himself as someone who's living in a society that's influenced by various thoughts and beliefs, including those of various religions, including Hinduism, Christianity and Islam. He says that the society is greatly concerned with astrology and Vastu, a thought from Hinduism. He says, as a student, what should be my viewpoint with regards to this?
He's correct in saying that these are very important in India. Astrology would probably be more important. It's usually called the, I think they call it the Vedanga, which means, it's a limb of the Vedas itself. It's a main pillar of the Vedas. Whereas the Vastu, which is actually something a bit akin to Feng Shui, where it's the proper alignment of buildings and the architecture of how it's going to be, where the bedroom has to be, where the toilet has to be, etc., etc., the kitchen, etc. This is something called the Upaveda, which is something a bit lesser, but it is used a lot in India. Now the thing is, where do we fit into all that as Muslims? The most we could say is that we do know that as a form of respect, we do try to not point our feet towards the Kaaba, for example, when we're sleeping or when we're sitting, whatever. We try not to do that, although there isn't any hard and fast rule about that either, but it's just something which personally respect. Some Muslims feel they have to do out of respect. But to actually go into astrology now is not to say that we don't accept that the movements of planets have any effect on us. They certainly do. Mm-hmm. But to go from there to have that, kind of direct your life, and to go and have to see somebody to ask them, is it okay for me to set out on a journey on this particular Thursday? Is it auspicious or not? And so he'll consult his books of astrology and tell you, well, it actually isn't. Mm-hmm. So you can imagine how much this will impair the life of the person and how much it will impair the economy as well, in practical terms. And it does. I've even seen cases where children who have fallen ill among my Hindu friends have been to see somebody, who's into astrology, and the expert would say, well, actually, it's all down to the letter by which the child's name starts. So it starts with S. You should choose a name that starts with I, for example, and then the child will get better. So you see, a lot of superstition creeps into this as well. So we shouldn't go into this, because this is very akin to palmistry. It's trying to divine, the future, to know how things are going to be by doing certain things and reading certain signs. The Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is on record for having said that whoever goes to a psychic or to somebody who's an expert in palmistry firstly, he said, they will show that they do not believe in what was revealed to me, first of all. Secondly, he said that their prayers will be rejected for 40 consecutive days after they've done that. So it's something for Muslims not to go into. So whether the planets have an effect on us or not, we should not base our great decisions in life on their movements. That's going too far. And it's bringing us into the domain of superstition. And so therefore we stay clear of it. So if, for example, a Muslim living in India is surrounded by people who believe in this, let's say that person is an architect, he should of course take into consideration the fears and the anxieties of the people, and he should consult them and should say that, are you fine with having your house in this way or that way according to your system of Vastu? So then they should tell him. And this is how, there's no harm in working along with people if it's for their own peace of mind. But as for the peace of mind of Muslims is concerned, we have nothing to do with these things at all.
And sometimes you do get this concept where people have indulged in such practices, and then the concern always is that, what if it was true? What if it was, oh, my palm said this, or the stars said this?
That's superstition, then, isn't it?
Which creeps in.
It means that you have no faith in God, because God is the one who determines your decree. He's the one who says that evil will befall you or good. And this is why we believe in that. And it's one of the parts of our iman, where we say, "Amantu billahi wa malaikatihi wa kutubihi wa rasulihi wal yawmil akhiri wal qadri khayrihi wa sharrihi." Min Allah Ta'ala, wal ba'thi ba'd al-maut. So we believe in Allah, we believe in His angels and His books and His messengers. We believe in the last day. We believe in the good destiny coming from Allah and the bad, and in the resurrection after death. We believe in all that. These are the articles of faith. So whatever comes from God, and we have to pray to Allah that Allah helps us to go through those, whatever He's decreed of evil for us in our lives, so that we can form our souls to be even better than they were before, that we can use them to our advantage, and that whatever good has been decreed to us, that doesn't make us lapse into evil, by lulling us into a false sense of security perhaps, or making us become arrogant or selfish perhaps. And so we have to ask for good wherever it is, whether in the difficult circumstances of life or the easy ones. But we shouldn't go around fearing, you know, what's going to happen. I mean, I was in Zaire, now the Congo, Belgian Congo, and I saw one day these young people who were walking around, you know, in the streets with one arm behind their backs. And when I asked, why are they doing this? They said, because today is the day of their exams, and they believe that if anyone shakes their hands, they are going to fail. So just to be very sure, they keep their hand behind their backs so that nobody shakes their hands. So it really, really impedes on your life. It makes things difficult, and it renders the economy, you know, all the more difficult to run when there are these superstitions that abound in society.
Jazakallah, young yourself for that, and anyone looking towards the stars for signs, well, put your faith in God is a simple answer to all of that. Jazakallah also to Wajahat Ahmed for your question. Our next one question comes from Sonia Khan. Again, thank you very much for your kind comments about faith matters. Dr. Zaitsab, she's actually talking of a particular example of the Holy Prophet, peace be upon him, who was said to carry out miracles by placing his hand or finger in a cup of water and it multiplied its volume. And of course, there's the famous feeding the 5,000 by Jesus, Prophet Jesus, Hazrat Isa alayhi salam as well. She's asking, could you shed some more light on these miracles? Are we talking in literal terms? Were they metaphoric sort of signs about how food can be shared? I mean, what was the significance of these, or did they really happen?
These are miracles, as you say, that are granted to prophets of Allah through the blessings of Allah. And these are in fact signs that are shown for people, that they recognize that this is a sign that has been shown for the truth of that prophet and for the existence of God Almighty as being behind the prophet as such. And we find in the Holy Quran and in other scriptures that prophets have been given these signs, and the Holy Prophet ﷺ was no exception. And there were many occasions, in fact, that he showed these signs to people, and this is something that has literally and practically happened. There was an incident when Hazrat Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu was very thirsty, and he kept asking the companions around him about the commentary of a certain verse of the Holy Quran. In fact, what he was trying to do was to try to point out to the fact that he was actually very thirsty at that time and he wanted some nourishment. And the companions, Hazrat Abu Bakr and Hazrat Umar, gave him some explanations, but the Holy Prophet ﷺ was listening to that, and then he called out to Hazrat Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu, and he said, collect all the companions around you who are actually in need of some nourishment. And he brought out a jug of milk from his house, and then he started offering this jug of milk to all the companions around him, and he offered it to the first companion and he drank his fill, and the Prophet said, no, drink some more, and he continued to drink his fill, and he said, no, drink some more, and he continued to drink. And this process continued around, and Hazrat Abu Huraira says that I was sitting on the other side thinking, this is one jug of milk. There'll be nothing left for me if this is what the Prophet of Allah is going to do to all the companions. Yes. You know, so this continued until it came to Hazrat Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu, and he found that he was drinking the milk, and the Prophet said, no, Abu Huraira, drink some more. And he drank some more, and he said, no, drink some more. And there was still some milk left in that jug. So this is signs that Allah shows to his prophets of Allah, and this is how he rewards them. And this is how we have seen in the life, as Sonia has mentioned, that these miracles do happen. They happened in the time of the promised Messiah, alayhi salam, as well. Exactly the same with the rice that was brought out from the promised Messiah's house, and there was a large gathering around him, and everybody partook of that one small bowl of rice. So these are signs that were given to the promised Messiah, alayhi salam, as well. And they are given to other saintly people as well, who actually have this affiliation, this connection with God Almighty, who are given these signs, and people are able to see, and physical signs. So these are blessings of Allah that do really happen to these prophets.
Jazakumullah, Dr. Saab, and as you said, there's numerous examples one can quote. And again, it shows the divine power of God Almighty and the truth of the messengers that God sends. In the sort of last sort of 6-7 minutes of the program, I'm going to try and sort of fit in two questions which on the sort of, hopefully we can get answers, sort of satisfactory answers out, because there are some questions which obviously require a lot more in-depth analysis and response. The first one, if I could come to you, to John Gusab, this is a question about angels. And do angels worship God in the same way, worship Allah in the same way humans do? I.e., do they perform five prayers? If so, when prayers are offered in congregation and angels are present, do they follow the imam leading the prayer?
Well, angels are not the same type of creatures as we are. And we really don't know how they glorify God. We know that they do glorify Him, but we don't know exactly how. And I doubt whether our Sharia would apply to them, as they don't have physical bodies as we do. They wouldn't have to do, for example, the ablutions before their prayers, etc. They wouldn't have to bow down on prayer mats, etc., or do the sujood. So they must have some other way of worshipping God, which is just as much worship as what human beings could worship God, whichever means they use, I mean. So we really don't know about that. So whatever I'm going to say here will be just mere guesswork. Yeah. And we can't really answer that question. The only thing we can say, as I said, is that the Holy Quran does mention the fact that angels glorify God and also sing His praises. So they do that. But in which way they do it, that only Allah knows. There are, of course, a hadith which may appear to show that angels pray like us, where, for example, the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said that if somebody finds himself outside, for example, in the desert, and doesn't find anyone else to pray with him, he should stand up and call for the prayer, give the call for the prayer, the adhan, and then he should do the aqama, and to say that the prayer is about, the announcement that the prayer is about to start, and then he should actually start and lead in prayer as if there were people praying behind him. Okay. And should he do that, then chances are that somebody who was passing by might hear and might join him, or if nobody joins him, then the angels themselves will come and stand in ranks behind him. So here we have some kind of an idea whereby we might think that the angels pray like the person does. But that just means that Allah will you know, fill in the gap for him and make good his shortcoming of not having a congregation and give him the blessing of the congregational prayer by sending angels, so to speak. That's a metaphor, of course, and I wouldn't take that literally.
So it's a reassurance, and of course, as you said, a belief in angels. For our non-Muslim viewers, the belief in angels is an actual article of faith within Islam.
Yes.
Zakumullah for that, young Yusuf. Next question is a technical one, and a dental question at that. It comes from Shafiq Khan Sahib in Germany. Asalaamu Alaikum, Shafiq Sahib. Thank you for your question. He's looking to get some braces because his teeth are not perfectly aligned, and he puts it kind of crooked, but I'm not sure cosmetic dental surgery, whether it's permissible. Is it haram? And I need an opinion. Who better to go to than a scholar of the Jamaat who's also a qualified dentist, Dr. Sahib?
Well, I'm going to say yes, because it's for my profession. You see, teeth are not only for our looks, cosmetics, but they're also for our function and they're for our speech as well. So if you have misalignment of teeth, it could be that they cause a problem in your function of chewing anyway, and also for your speech. So that could be one of the reasons why you would want them straightened. But also, if they are misaligned, then you can obviously straighten them for your cosmetic, for your looks, and that will help your function of mastication and eating as well. So it is not haram to that degree. Some people ask about a hadith of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in which he said that the filing down of teeth was something that should not be, people should not do. That was something that was totally different, and it was damaging to the teeth. So it is the damage that he was warning people against, that if you file teeth away, they're obviously going to become sensitive and they're going to be more prone to decay and so on. So you're ruining something that Allah has given you in that respect. But this is to enhance and improve whatever Allah has given to you. In that respect, it is permissible in Islam, and there is nothing that is contrary to Islam that we cannot carry out this procedure.
Zakullah, just as an aside to that, so brace, as you said, these are functional things as well, but taking the concept of cosmetic surgery per se, you know, some people, for sheer sort of reasons of vanity, I suppose, nothing more, may look to get things done, for example, noses which are crooked may be fixed, which again may be perfectly legitimate if it improves someone's breathing, but others do it for the sake of just getting things done. And in this modern age, all these nips and tucks, you know, on faces to make people look younger and certainly look younger for a longer period of time than their natural aging process would allow. Is that permissible? Is that allowed?
Well, that is not something that Islam encourages, that we should go down this line of being under the scalpel all the time and having all these procedures done in order to enhance our looks to that degree, and also trying to delay the aging process as such, and trying to lose parts of your body, where trying to lose fat and so on. So Islam does not encourage to that degree. These are lavish things, and they are very expensive procedures, and they have their dangers as well. As far as surgery, any surgery is going to be prone to danger, so you are actually putting yourself in danger to that degree, and this is something that you should not be going down that line unless it is for the betterment of your health as such. If it is better for your health when the doctors prescribe this treatment for you in that respect, then that is something that is permissible, but beyond that, these limits should not be transgressed by man itself.
So I suppose the questioner will have to brace themselves for the procedure. Sorry for the pun.
And I will close it at that. I'll let viewers judge how effective that was. But no, gentlemen, as ever, thank you to both of you for your very scholarly and detailed answers. And my thanks also to viewers. Without you, Faith Matters would not be the program it is. Just as a final reminder in closing of the email address, for those not yet familiar with our address here, for any comments, thoughts, observations on what you've heard today, or any other questions you may have, the email address is faithmatters@mta.tv. That's faithmatters, one word, @mta.tv. From all of us here on the Faith Matters team, until next time from London, Assalamu alaikum.